This is the second of two lectures where we are learning electromagnetic properties of ordinary materials. This is before we go ahead in and structure them to give them the properties that we want. This lecture will build on the last one and talk about some stranger things that happen, specifically nonlinear and anisotropic material properties. We will briefly do nonlinear because that's not a big part of this semester course, but we will spend some time on anisotropic materials because that will crop up again during the semester and also in the homework. Nonlinear materials. If we remember from last time, we had an electron cloud buzzing around the nucleus and it was symmetric. Along comes an electric field and it pushes the electron cloud and the nucleus in opposite directions. We induce a dipole, an electric dipole, and of course the electric field is oscillating, so this electron cloud is shaking back and forth around the nucleus and re-radiating these little tiny waves. And we average that effect over trillions of atoms, and we got an overall slowing response that we called the dielectric response. It turns out, just like a mass on a spring, that this system's really only linear if we only push on it a little bit. Well, what happens if we pull on that spring really hard, or we drive it with a very strong electric field? Well, it turns out the displacement of this electron cloud is not really a linear function. So in the absence of knowing anything else, it turns out we can express the polarization in terms of the electric field, just in terms of a polynomial. And we'll have the chi 1 term on the left, that's the standard linear response, but we have chi 1 times e plus a chi 2 times e squared plus a chi 3 times e cubed, and so on. We just expand it into a polynomial. Well, the chi 1 is the linear response. That's what we've done so far. What we're going to talk about in the next few slides is the chi 2, chi 3, chi 4 terms. These are the nonlinear material properties, and some really interesting things happen. Folks like to describe this in terms of a potential well. Think of V as the potential of how hard you're driving something, and R is the displacement. In a linear system where you push on that and it displaces in the linear region, we get a potential well that looks something like this, a nice smooth potential well. And if we drive this harmonically and we look at the position of R, we get a nice cosine response. Well, it turns out all this changes when this potential well is nonlinear. So here, for example, our potential well is not linear. What we can see is that around here we have approximately the potential well we had on the previous slide, and it looks very linear. However, we see, even though we're pushing it much, much harder here, the displacement is much less, and it turns out we get a nonlinear response if we drive things very hard. In fact, all materials are nonlinear, so it's not even really a correct question to say, well, what materials are nonlinear? All materials are nonlinear. There are, however, some that we can see the nonlinear properties a lot sooner or with weaker electromagnetic fields. So those are the ones that we tend to call nonlinear. However, everything is nonlinear. So let's think about what happens when we drive something with this non-symmetric kind of ill-shaped potential well. And this results in something we call anharmonic oscillation. So rather than the displacement looking like a cosine, it looks something like this, where it's clipped a little bit. That's because in this region, when we drive it hard, it displaces less. So we get a clipped looking cosine. Well, a clipped looking cosine is not a cosine. And we can decompose that now into a Fourier series where we have a pure cosine, followed by one at twice the frequency, three times, and so on. So it's actually the sum of these that reconstruct that, the original sort of clipped cosine function. So what does that mean? Well, that means we no longer have a single pure frequency. In fact, we have a whole bunch of other ones. And our oscillator is oscillating at a bunch of frequencies at the same time. So this is really the source of frequency mixing, optical rectification, and so on. Sometimes, just due to how the atomic lattices, charges will displace in one direction much easier than they will in the opposite direction. And we get this non-symmetric or asymmetric potential well. So what happens is the charge will spend more time on one side of the atom than the other. And if we look at this harmonically, we drive it, it's almost like a cosine, except it's clipped on this side and spends more time on the other side where the charge is more easily displaced. Well, let's look at the DC component. In fact, the charge is spending more time on one side, so there's a DC component, which means there's a DC component to the electric field. And one area this manifests itself is something called optical rectification. We can apply light to a crystal that has a non-symmetric potential well, and if we put electrodes on either side of that, we will see a voltage. We can categorize nonlinear material properties in terms of the chi, and the way this is worded, chi 1, chi 2, chi 3, and so on. The chi 1, these are the ordinary materials. In chi 2 materials, this is where we have the asymmetric well, and we get things like rectification. We see that it's a nonlinear, so we get frequency doubling, parametric mixing, where we put in waves at different frequencies and we get out sums and differences. Then the chi 3 materials, things are symmetric, but very nonlinear. And one of the most common ones, or most well known, is something called the Kerr effect, where if we look at the dielectric constant of a material, or its refractive index, if we drive it harder, that refractive index or dielectric constant will actually change. And one thing neat that kind of happens is something called self-focusing. We know if we have an electromagnetic beam that's more intense at the middle. Well, suppose that's propagating through a material, and suddenly the middle part of the beam is increasing the refractive index on itself. Well, that's going to form a lens, so the beam now focuses. And usually this ends up with smoke and something blows up. But the Kerr effect is definitely something that's known. It definitely happens. And sometimes it can even be used beneficially. Sometimes it's not so beneficial. So that's all I really want to say about nonlinear materials, because we're really not going to be handling those this semester. And being so brief, I don't want to say that there's not a lot to nonlinear materials, because in fact there's probably more to nonlinear materials than there are anisotropic materials. It's a really neat area, and people have devoted their careers to nothing other than nonlinear material properties. But it's not what we're going to be doing this semester, so I want to spend the most of our time in this lecture on anisotropic materials. So what is an anisotropic material? Back to this electron cloud shaking around the nucleus of an atom. Keep in mind, I keep using that analogy. However, there are other resonance mechanisms, but let's stick with that. Just due to the construction of the lattice, there are certain directions where those charges will displace more than they would in a different direction. The example I have here is a sliding glass door. So imagine you push on a sliding glass door at a 45-degree angle. Well, that sliding glass door, in terms of in and out, is not free to displace in that direction. However, it is free to displace along the sliding. So even though we're pushing on it at a 45-degree angle, the door actually displaces primarily to the left here. Well, the same thing can happen at the atomic scale. We will apply an electric field to push the charges, but because of what's happening at the atomic scale, those charges actually displace in a slightly different direction, simply because they're more free to go in some directions than others. So in order to account for this, remember we had polarization equals our susceptibility times the electric field. Of course, there's this constant of free space permittivity out here. But now, since the polarization can be at a different direction in the electric field, it turns out our susceptibility becomes a tensor. It's a 3x3 matrix. There's three vector components in E, three vector components in P, and this becomes a tensor. And a tensor is a generalization to a scalar. If we multiply a vector by a scalar, it changes its magnitude, but the direction's the same. Well, we can generalize that concept, where if we multiply a vector by a tensor, that tensor can not only change the magnitude of the vector, but also its direction. So in anisotropic material properties, susceptibility, dielectric constant, permittivity, permeability, even conductivity, these become tensor quantities. So at the atomic scale, we can look at things, and very often visually we can say that, well, if this is our atomic lattice, clearly maybe we don't know whether charges are more easily displaced this way than another way, but we certainly could say, I can see intuitively why it will be different. So clearly a lattice like this has a good potential to become anisotropic. So here's the math behind it. We start off with susceptibility, and this is a 3x3 tensor because any one of the XYZ components of the electric field can induce a polarization in the XYZ directions, in principle anyway. And we describe this with a 3x3 tensor. Well, the susceptibility is related to the permittivity this way. The relative permittivity is 1 plus the susceptibility. Well, if susceptibility is a tensor, so is the dielectric constant. And in fact, this is the one that we use when we're solving Maxwell's equations, where the permittivity becomes a tensor. So the X, Y, and Z components, the X component of the electric field can end up inducing a Z component of the D field, for example. Any one of the components of E can become any one of the components of D. That's what's described by a 3x3 tensor. Now, we cannot arbitrarily choose all 9 elements of that tensor. There's some rules and restrictions. One restriction is that that has to have Hermitian symmetry. So if we look at elements that are on either side of the diagonal, these essentially have to be the same, but they're complex conjugates of each other when we have loss. If there's no loss, they're the same numbers. Another restriction, which we'll see on other slides, is that we live in a three-dimensional world, so there really are only 3 degrees of freedom in these tensors. We can only pick 3 numbers. The way we get 9 numbers is when we rotate the coordinate system of that tensor, and then those 3 numbers, which were going down the diagonal, end up in the off diagonals. And we'll see that in some following slides. So we can always choose axes A, B, and C. They don't have to be at 90 degrees with respect to each other, but we can always choose to look at our tensor along A, B, and C axes such that our tensor is diagonalized. We see there's an epsilon in the A direction, an epsilon in the B direction, an epsilon in the C direction. Now we usually choose A, B, and C to be consistent with the axes of the anisotropic crystal. So we see that there's only 3 numbers that we can pick here. The reason that we get numbers in these off-diagonal terms is if we want to analyze that anisotropic material in coordinates that are different than A, B, and C. So let's say we're analyzing things in X, Y, Z. We plop down a crystal, but then we turn it. Suddenly, its crystal axes are different than our X, Y, Z axes, and we get numbers in the off-diagonal terms. But since there's only 3 degrees of freedom, that's why there's these restrictions on what those numbers can be in the off-diagonal terms. Unfortunately, we're not free to just arbitrarily choose 9 completely different numbers. So let's look at Maxwell's equations with anisotropic media. Well, Maxwell's equations themselves, these are unchanged. So there is no difference. Where the anisotropy goes into are the constitutive relations. The D equals epsilon E and the B equals mu H. So this constitutive relation expands to this, where our permittivity is now a 3x3 tensor. I don't show it here, but the permeability is also another 3x3 tensor. So an H field pointing in one direction, turns out, can produce a B field in a different direction if the permeability is anisotropic. So this is where we start for an electromagnetic analysis with anisotropic materials. And it's very handy that Maxwell's equations themselves have not changed. It's just the constitutive relations that now have tensors instead of the scalars that we assumed before. By looking at the crystal symmetry, we can make a pretty darn good guess of whether it's what type of anisotropy it has. And there's 3. There's isotropic, uniaxial, and biaxial. And the reasons for those labels will become apparent later on. But in isotropic media, if the crystal lattice has cubic symmetry, we will have an isotropic material. So that is, no matter what direction a field is oscillating, it sees the same dielectric constant. But if we write the permittivity as a tensor anyway, that just means that all three elements down the diagonal are the same number. So we can still write isotropic materials as if they're anisotropic. It's just the three numbers we pick will always be the same. Hexagonal and tetragonal lattices will have what's called uniaxial symmetry. And take this lattice, for example. If we have an electric field oscillating in this direction or this direction, it essentially sees the same thing. So we see two axes in uniaxial crystals that look the same. But a field oscillating in a third direction has to see a different dielectric constant. So in uniaxial anisotropic crystals, we see two axes that have the same dielectric constant and a third one that's different. And now we have different dielectric constants, we can define what we call birefringence. And this is where we see two different refractive indices or two different dielectric constants. When the extraordinary dielectric constant is greater than the ordinary dielectric constant, we call that positive birefringence. And also the reason we call them ordinary and extraordinary will become apparent later. If the extraordinary dielectric constant is less than the ordinary, we call that negative birefringence. All other crystal symmetries are what we call biaxial, and this just means that all three dielectric constants are different. And the convention is that we'll put them in order with the lowest dielectric constant in the upper left and the highest dielectric constant in the lower right. So we are describing anisotropic materials with tensors. And so if we're going to treat this mathematically, we have to understand how to rotate our tensors so we can analyze something anisotropic when the tensor's been rotated and it's not, when the crystal axes are not consistent with the axes we're choosing to model. And very often we'll get a tensor, we'll have nine elements, and we ask ourselves, how on earth do we know what we started with? What were the three original dielectric constants, and how has it been rotated? So I'll call that unrotation. First, let's define something called a rotation matrix. Suppose we have a vector A, and it's pointing in some arbitrary direction, and I don't want to change the magnitude. All I want to do is rotate this by some angle phi to get a vector B. So vector B and A are very similar vectors. They have the same magnitude. They're just pointing in different directions, and they differ by some angle phi. Well, it turns out I can construct a square matrix such that if I pre-multiply that by A, or I'm sorry, I'm pre-multiplying A by this rotation matrix, I will get that vector B. Now, as long as A and B are not changing directions, not changing magnitudes, we will call this the rotation matrix. Now, because the rotation matrix does not change the magnitude of the vector, it's what we call unitary. And what that means is the Hermitian transpose and the inverse will be the same thing. So that's a very useful property. But remember, we're not changing magnitude here. We are just rotating a vector by pre-multiplying with a rotation matrix, which is a 3x3 matrix. So let's derive what goes into that 3x3 matrix. So I drew again our A rotating by angle phi into B. We can write A in general as an X component and a Y component. And if it is at some angle theta, so between this and the horizontal axis will be angle theta, we can write our A vector this way. Well, now that we have it written this way, we can real easily add a phi to it. So now here we have an expression for our B vector. Well, we use our trig identities. So here we have a cosine A plus B. We have a sine A plus B. We can use our trig identities and expand that. And then we can go back to our original A vector and factor out the A sub X and A sub Y inside of B. So here's an expression for what B equals now. Now it's easy when we look at this to see what matrix we multiply A by in order to get B. So this is rotation in two dimensions. This is our rotation matrix to rotate A by angle phi. Now what we need to do is extend this to three dimensions. So in three dimensions, we have three different axes that we can rotate about. So here on the left, we're rotating about the x-axis by some angle phi. We're starting with A, and we're rotating by angle phi into B. And what we see is that we now, our rotation matrix is 3 by 3, but we can see the elements of the original 2D rotation matrix follow with a column and row. They're all zeros, but a one in the diagonal position, meaning this x-axis remains unchanged. Whatever component of A lies along the x-axis won't change, but the y and z axes sort of scramble themselves to do the rotation. Likewise, we can rotate about the y-axis, and we'll rotate A into B through some angle phi. Again, we see the four elements from our rotation matrix, but now the second row and column with a one in the middle tells us that the y-axis is remaining unchanged. Also, when we rotate about the z-axis by angle phi, we see the four elements of our original 2D rotation matrix, but the row and column corresponding to the z-axis with a one in the middle position says the z-axis remains unchanged. So what we have at the bottom here are three-dimensional rotation matrices. The first one rotates about the x-axis, the second one rotates about the y-axis, and the third one rotates about the z-axis. And all of those by an angle phi, and by observation almost, we can take our 2D rotation matrix and construct these. And in fact, that's how it's done. So what is tensor rotation? Well, let's say we're modeling a device in X, Y, and Z coordinates. And this red cube is some kind of anisotropic crystal that we lay down, and real easily its crystal axes correspond along to the XYZ axes. So our epsilon starts off as a diagonal tensor and everything's easy. But because I'm a cruel professor and I say, no, we are going to rotate this crystal by some angle phi. So suddenly the crystal axes of our anisotropic material no longer correspond to X, Y, and Z. So we need to rotate that tensor by that angle phi to get this new 9-element tensor that describes our anisotropy but in our XYZ coordinates. So we construct our rotation matrix. Here we're rotating about Z by angle phi. Shown in red here is our original tensor. That's the diagonal tensor containing only three numbers going down the center diagonal. Now, unlike rotating vectors, here we're rotating the coordinates of a tensor. And so this is a little bit different. We not only pre-multiply by the rotation matrix, but we post-divide by the rotation matrix. So we actually do both here, and that rotates the coordinates of this tensor, and we get our new tensor. Now remember, what I'm showing in blue here is the exact same crystal as what's shown in here. It's just that we're looking at it in a coordinate system that is different than the crystal axes. We can do combinations of rotations. Maybe we rotate about the x-axis, then we rotate about the y-axis, then we rotate about the z-axis, and we get a crazy combination of rotations, and who knows what direction B will be pointing. So if we rotate about the x-axis first, we pre-multiply by the rotation in x. Then here's our new B, if you will. We pre-multiply this by our rotation in Y, then we have a new B, we pre-multiply it by our rotation in Z, and now we have our final B that's been rotated three different times. Tensors, if we do this, we'll have our original tensor. If we rotate about X, we have to pre-multiply and post-divide. So now what I'm circling will be our tensor rotated about the X-axis. Then we pre-multiply and post-divide by our y, and now we have our tensor that's been rotated twice, about x, once about x and once about y, and then we do our z rotation, and we end up with our final rotated matrix. So we can combine these, and we can do even stranger rotations. So if we are rotating x, y, z, we can construct what I call the composite rotation matrix. So it's all three matrices multiplied together, and we get a composite rotation matrix. So with this single matrix, we can just pre-multiply A and get the rotated B, or with that single matrix, we can pre-multiply and post-divide to get our rotated tensor. Very often, this is the easiest way to do it. So here's some numerical examples, given the equations on previous slides. I won't spend too much time here other than to describe what I'm doing. So we start off with this original tensor, and we want to rotate about the x-axis by 20 degrees. Well, first I calculate that rotation matrix, and notice we have a column and a row with all zeros except the one in the center position and some numbers here that will scramble numbers in the y and z coordinates. If we take this rotation matrix and pre-multiply and post-divide this tensor, here's our new tensor. Notice we still have 0, 0, a 1 here, just like in the original tensor. So this x-axis has not changed because we're rotating about the x-axis. We're really only scrambling y and z quantities. And then we rotate about the y-axis by 45 degrees, rotation matrix, the final tensor. And again, it's the same. We get a 2 in the second position because the y-axis is not changing. We're rotating about it. It's the x and z axes that are scrambling. Then we rotate about the z-axis by 60 degrees, our rotation matrix, final tensor. And again, we've got a 3 in that final position, just like up here, because we're not changing the z-axis. We're rotating about it. So in writing your code, when you're rotating tensors, use this to make sure that you're calculating the rotation matrices correctly and rotating your tensors correctly. Here's an example where we're combining multiple rotations. The first example, we are rotating around the x-axis by 20 degrees and then also rotating about the y-axis by 45 degrees. That's the second rotation. So here I'm showing you the composite rotation matrices and the final tensors. Another topic we can talk about now that we're experts in tensor rotation, is tensor unrotation. And so suppose you're given a 9x9 tensor. And then I ask, well, what were the original three dielectric constants? And in what orientation is that crystal? It turns out by looking at these 9 tensor elements, we can determine all that. So here's what a tensor looks like if it's diagonalized along its principal axes. In other words, the axes that we're analyzing it are the same as the crystal axes. We'll get a diagonal tensor. Any other time, we get full 9 elements. Well, given that full 9 element, what was the original tensor? What are the axes? What were the three original dielectric constants? So, remember the composite rotation matrix. We started off with our diagonal tensor, we pre-multiply and post-divide, and we get the rotated tensor. So this is the one that I would hand you and ask you, what are the original three dielectric constants and what are the axes? Well, it turns out we have a 3x3 matrix. We can calculate the eigenvectors and eigenvalues. The eigenvalues is a diagonal matrix, and it turns out the elements going down the diagonal of the diagonal matrix, that's the original unrotated tensor. So that tells you the three dielectric constants. The eigenvector matrix, as it turns out, is that rotation matrix. And what we'll see in a few slides is if we look at the columns of this composite rotation matrix, those are the crystal axes. So let's look at this and think of it this way. Let's come up with a matrix that contains along its columns our principal axes. We can take our principal axes and rotate those by pre-multiplying by a rotation matrix to get our principal axes in the rotated coordinate system. Now notice we're not post-dividing by this because we're not interpreting P as a tensor here. We are storing vectors in its columns and we want to rotate those. So these are our original principal axes. These are the principal axes after the rotation. So probably, originally, our principal axes were just along, consistent with X, Y, and Z directions. So A would be in the X direction, B in the C direction, and C in the Z direction. I'm sorry, B is in the Y direction, C is in the Z direction. So we would start off like this. That's the identity matrix. So if we take this P and rotate it, that's the identity matrix times a rotation matrix, that's our rotation matrix back again. And so that is also our principal axes in the rotated coordinate systems. So this tells us if we have this composite rotation matrix, we interpret its columns as the principal axes in the rotated coordinate system. That's pretty neat. So by calculating the eigenvectors and eigenvalues of a 9-element tensor, we know its axes, we know how it's been rotated, and we know what the original 3 dielectric constants were. So it turns out, by what we've talked about, rather than if we know the orientation of the crystal that we want, but we're trying to think about, well, how much do I rotate about X? How much do I rotate about Y? And maybe we're struggling to figure that out, but we know the orientation of the crystal we want. We can kind of forget what we know about the rotation matrices and just create a vector R where we let the columns be however we want our crystal axes oriented. So we just directly construct this matrix how we want things oriented, call that our composite rotation matrix, treat it just like we did before, and what we get is our rotated tensor. And so we can do this directly without having to think about rotation matrices. So a consequence of all this is the dispersion relation and something called index ellipsoids. And index ellipsoids is something later on that we're going to call isofrequency contours. So to understand this, let's look at the wave vector. So the wave vector, we usually write it as a vector K, and it carries two pieces of information. The magnitude of K is 2 pi divided by the wavelength. So the magnitude conveys the spatial period of the wave. Well, if the free space wavelength is known, then that's fixed, then the magnitude of K really conveys refractive index. And in fact, most of the time, this is how I think of it, is the magnitude of K conveying refractive index. But that's only the case when the free space wavelength is known. The other part of K is direction, and this tells us the direction of the wave. So if we go over here and we look at the wave, we see we have these wave fronts, and the wave is propagating from lower left to upper right along the direction of K. So this black arrow would be K. And it's always perpendicular to the wave fronts in the direction of the wave. So in summary, two pieces of information. The magnitude of K conveys refractive index, and the direction of K conveys the direction that the wave is trying to go. The dispersion relation essentially is an equation describing the magnitude of K as a function of direction. Now, in most ordinary materials, the magnitude of K is fixed. It's the same no matter what direction we want to go. So we can write an equation something like what's shown here, where we just square and sum the three components of K. So what we have on the left is the magnitude of K, and we see that the magnitude of K is fixed to this value. So that makes sense. No matter what direction a wave is trying to go in outer space or in an ordinary material, it sees the same magnitude of K. That equation that we just wrote, if we look at that, we see that that is the equation for a sphere. And in fact, we can plot a sphere, and we call this the index ellipsoid. And we think of the index ellipsoid as a map of refractive index as a function of direction through the lattice. So if no matter what direction the wave is trying to go, if it sees the same refractive index, this surface is a sphere. Real quickly, how do we derive the dispersion relation for fully anisotropic materials? Let's step through this. We start with a wave equation, but we have a tensor for the dielectric constant. We know we have plane wave solutions. We may not know what those look like, but we know they're plane wave solutions. So we can write it in general this way, where we have some polarization vector, and then we have the phase term, e to the minus jkr. And this polarization term we can write in general as three vector components. We won't know what those are. They can be complex numbers, and this could be pointing in any direction. But we can take this solution and substitute that back into the original wave equation, and we end up with an equation in this form. And if we turn the crank on the math, what we really end up with is a big ugly term in the A direction, plus a big ugly term in the B direction, plus a big ugly term in the C direction. Now each one of these big ugly terms has this form. There's a big ugly expression multiplying the A component of the electric field, another big ugly expression multiplying the B component, and another big ugly expression multiplying the C component. Well, if we go back to this first equation, if this all equals zero, then that means each component separately must equal zero. And so in fact, we can write three equations. And each of these equations will be in the form of this second equation up here. Well, this group of three equations, we can now write in matrix form. Remember, this originally came from the wave equation. We substituted in our assumed solution and turned the crank, and we ended up here. And this is a big, ugly expression. Well, the values of K that satisfy that are the eigenvalues of that matrix. So we can calculate that by setting the determinant equal to zero, and an equation falls out of that. The solutions to that equation are our valid values of K, or the eigenvalues. And to make a long story short, here's what that equation looks like. And it turns out with these restrictions on K, we can then write what that polarization vector looks like. So, for the general case where all three components along the tensor are different, this is the general form of the dispersion relation. And a somewhat maybe more useful form is down here. So now what we're going to look at are some special cases of this. In uniaxial crystals, we have two directions that experience the same dielectric constant or the same refractive index. We will call that the ordinary axis, and we'll see why in a little bit. And then the third is the extraordinary refractive index, or extraordinary dielectric constant. So we go back to the dispersion relation and we put it in a slightly different form. And it turns out this is a very meaningful form to write that dispersion relation for a uniaxial crystal. And what we see is the product of two things. On the left, this is an equation for a sphere. This is an equation for an ellipse. So in fact, this uniaxial crystal has two indexed ellipsoids at the same time. It has a sphere. Remember, we encountered spheres when we were talking about ordinary materials. So this, we have basically two waves that can propagate. One is an ordinary wave, and then the other, where the dispersion surface or the index ellipsoid is not a sphere, it's an ellipse. It either looks more like a cucumber or a pill, is our extraordinary wave. So what do these look like? Well, clearly our spherical solution looks like a sphere. Our ellipse, there's two families of ellipses. There's the cucumbers or egg-shaped, and then there's the flat pill-shaped. Really, both of these are happening at the same time. So this a uniaxial crystal really has two dispersion surfaces or two index ellipsoids at the same time. Now, they touch at the top and the bottom. So here, the ordinary and extraordinary surfaces touch. So in fact, we call this the optic axis. This is the ordinary axis. And waves traveling along this direction really just see one refractive index or one dielectric constant. It looks ordinary. And so it has one axis that looks ordinary. So we call it uniaxial. And that's where that word comes from. Any other direction, there's two possible refractive indices or dielectric constants that a wave could see, the ordinary and the extraordinary. Biaxial is even more crazy, and here's sort of my cartoonish way of visualizing this. The blue and the red are the two surfaces. They're crazy looking, but imagine these are like sacks or balloons. But we pinch them together at four different points. And these two points are at exact opposite sides of the coordinate system. and these two points are at exact opposite sides of the coordinate system. Now, since the two surfaces are pinched together at the same point, that means propagation along this axis, the ordinary and extraordinary refractive indices or dielectric constants are the same. So we actually now have two axes that look ordinary. Well, if we have two ordinary looking axes, that's why we name this a biaxial crystal. Two axes where propagation appears to be ordinary. Away from that, it gets crazy, and the two surfaces can be very different. It's easier to come up with special cases where we can say that there is no propagation component in the A direction, in which case our dispersion relation reduces to this, or no propagation in the B direction, our dispersion relation reduces to that, and so on. So these tend to be the ones when we're working with biaxial crystals that we use. Now I want to talk about phase and power flow inside any material, in this case anisotropic material. So we're just restricted to two dimensions right now. So we're looking at here, instead of an index ellipsoid, I guess we'd call this an index circle, or we could think of it as a cross section of an index ellipsoid. We construct our K vector, which goes from the origin to a point on the surface. So the K vector is the direction that phase is trying to go, or the direction phase is going. The power flows in a way that we define differently. It flows in a direction that is perpendicular to the tangent to the surface. So I'm highlighting the tangent to the surface. Power flows perpendicular to that. Well, when our index ellipsoid, if you will, is a circle or a sphere, the K vector and the pointing vector are in the same direction. And we tend to get programmed of, this is just how all materials work. The phase and the power flow in the same direction. And in fact, that only happens for isotropic materials. Let's look at the anisotropic case. Here we have an index ellipsoid now. We have phase that is going in this direction. That is our K vector. It connects the origin to a point on the surface. However, look what happens with power. The tangent to this surface is now sloped like this. And so power flows in this direction. So the power flow and the phase flow are in different directions. The pointing vector and the K vector are in different directions. And this seems magical and wonderful, but I would argue this is actually the case most of the time. Most materials are anisotropic. The isotropic case is certainly easier to analyze, and so that's what we learn in a classroom most of the time. But some very interesting things happen in anisotropic materials. So here's what it looks like when phase and power are going in different directions. So we have the interface between two materials. And in material one, we see our wave fronts. We see the white, black, those are the wave fronts. So K is always perpendicular to that. Phase is flowing along this blue vector. But we also see the shape of a beam, and we can see that there's a beam traveling in that same direction. That's the pointing vector. Well, then we pass into a material where things are different. And we can see that we still see the black, white, and the wave fronts appear to be going in this direction along the K vector. That's the direction phase appears to be going. However, we can see the profile of the beam, that the beam is actually going to the left. So our pointing vector is in this direction. And this is what it looks like when the pointing vector and the wave vector are in different directions. And the analogy I like to use, imagine you stand still, and then you spin in a circle real fast 20 times so you're really dizzy, and then you stare at a picture on the wall and you start walking toward it. You're facing that. That's the direction, that's the way you want to go. That's the way phase is going. However, because you're dizzy, your body's actually going off in some other direction. And since your body's actually going in another direction, that's the pointing vector. And so waves inside these anisotropic materials are running this dizzy race where they spun around in circles and phase is trying to go one way, but the beam is actually going another. It's pretty interesting. So let's talk about phase matching into anisotropic materials to get an idea of what's happening. So on the left, we have the ordinary case. We have an ordinary material one and an ordinary material two. The ordinary material too has a higher refractive index here, so that's why the index ellipsoid, if you will, is larger than the first material. We're just drawing half of the index ellipsoid in each of the materials. So if we have an incoming wave vector, because this surface is defining the magnitude of the wave vector, it has to connect the origin to a point on the surface. That's the only option we have. Well, we drop a little projection down, and in orange here, that's the transverse wave vector of the component, or the transverse component of the wave vector. Boundary conditions requires that to be continuous across the interface, so it has to be the same thing down here. Well, we just copied over here. We drop a projection down so it hits a point on the surface, and now from the origin to a point on the surface, that is the refracted wave in the second medium. So this is the rigorous way to predict refraction. Snell's law really only works for ordinary materials. This phase matching technique works for about anything. So now let's look at case two. We have the same ordinary material, probably air, and now it's matching into something that's anisotropic, and we have two index ellipsoids now. We have the ordinary and the extraordinary. Well, the ordinary one is a sphere or a circle in this case, and the other one is an ellipse. Well, let's look what happens here. We have our same incoming wave. We drop a projection down. Here's the transverse component. That has to be continuous across the interface. So we just copy it over here, and we drop a projection down, and it crosses both of these surfaces. So we actually have two possibilities for refracted waves. We could refract into the ordinary mode, or we could refract into the extraordinary mode. And in fact, this happens all the time. Here's a, I believe it's a calcite crystal, and we lay this crystal on top of some text, and we see double text. And what's happening is this is an anisotropic crystal, and it is refracting twice, one as an extraordinary wave and one as an ordinary wave. And we actually see this twice. It's a real physical thing.